We've been told that statins are safer than over-the-counter medications. But is that really true? Let's take a look into that. Stay tuned. While I was doing my research for one of my upcoming videos on side effects and the different kinds that we can have, I got sidetracked onto something and it brought up an important point. So we're going to revisit something. You may recall I gave the five worst prostatin ideas in a series, and one of them was make them available over the counter. So we're going to get back into that. So here's a prostatin position, and I think it's fair to characterize it as that. And it was an editorial written by a doctor in an article entitled Why I Think It's Time to Make Statins Available Over the Counter. And in it, this doctor said, have you ever bought aspirin or ibuprofen over the counter? Sure you have. In my view, statins are in fact safer than these drugs and provide more benefit. Well, let's take a look at that. If you look closely at the thumbnail for this video, you may have noticed that there were a couple chemical hazard labels on this keg of atorvastatin, which is Lipitor. And that wasn't just hyperbole. I didn't make those up. Those are actually from an international database. Here are statin chemical formulas. One little side thing here. You know, I've always said if you look at the generic name of a statin, it'll end in statin, and that's how you know you're dealing with one. They actually all end in Vascular, something I never noticed before. Just a little bit of trivia. I don't know if it has any significance. Someday maybe I'll look into the naming of these things. But you notice all these formulas are fairly similar. Well, there's two groups. They all have numerous carbon atoms and numerous hydrogen atoms. There's five of them that have a fluorine and some number of nitrogen atoms. And then they all have oxygen atoms, and one, Crestor, actually has a sulfur atom in it. So you could break these into two groups. The reason cerivastatin is down at the bottom, and you may never have heard of that, Bakal, well, it was removed from the market because it was found to cause too high of a percentage of rhabdomyolysis. Well, looking at these formulas really doesn't tell us a lot. It's hard to even guess how these things may interact with human physiology. And it doesn't tell the whole story. Things that look very similar may not be. The only way to really tell is to look at the three-dimensional structures of these molecules. So here's three of them. Here's the three statins that I've been on in my lifetime. Pitavastatin or Livalo or Livalo, however that's pronounced. Rosuvastatin, which is Crestor. And Atorvastatin, which is Lipitor. And you notice that despite the similarity in the chemical formula, which just gives you the number of molecules, it's not like you'd throw that number of molecules together and you would come out with something like this. They go together in a particular structure. You'll see that the structures are not really all that similar for complicated molecules. If you were to look at these independently, not knowing that they were all statins, you might not guess that they were actually related molecules. So the next thing I just want to point out, those chemical hazard symbols, there's nine of them that are put out by the Globally Harmonized System of Classification and Labeling of Chemicals. So that's an international organization that does this. And out of these nine, no statins are considered explosive, oxidizers, or compressed gases. And that kind of makes sense to us. But these other six symbols actually apply to a lot of the statins. So let's take a look at that. So here's a chart from left to right. That first column is acute toxicity, then corrosive, then a health hazard. The next one is irritant, then flammable, and environmental hazard. This database that I got this from, these are actually from the laboratory chemical safety summary data sheets for these chemicals. It's really a manufacturing database. It's talking about the exposure and the harms that can come to the employees involved in the manufacture of these chemicals and what they may have to have for personal protective equipment and that sort of thing. So we've got to understand that this isn't necessarily at the doses of the milligrams that we might take. It's for people being exposed around these chemicals, barrels full of it. They may be inhaling dust from it, that sort of thing. But nevertheless, it tells us the relative safety profile or lack of safety profile of these particular chemicals. And this is self-reported. And in fact, I really believe that a lot of these empty boxes could be checked off. I mean, I've looked at some and there's a lot more that seem to be environmentally dangerous than has reported just by what they say about them. We have to take all of this with a grain of salt. I think this is a database that is under development, but it's what we have for the moment. So I want to take a deeper look at just one of them. I picked simvastatin because I had three check marks next to it. And here's the statement from that laboratory chemical safety summary data sheet. And you'll see that, well, it causes skin irritation, it causes serious eye damage, suspected of causing cancer, may damage fertility or unborn child, may cause harm to breastfed children. This is why statins are never given to pregnant women or breastfeeding women. causes damage to organs through prolonged or repeated exposure. So I just want to highlight that one because we're going to get back to that one in a little while. Harmful to aquatic life with long-lasting effects. That's why I think this should have the environmental hazard check mark on it. And there are a few others like that. And there were some that probably should have the acute toxicity that it wasn't mentioned on there, or cancer-causing agent. Like I said, the labels aren't perfect, but you'll see that there were a lot of these labels on these statins. If we go down to the precautionary statement codes just below, and you'll see a bunch of P numbers there, I pulled those out of their database, and you'll see that they say things like, do not breathe dust, fume, gas, mist, vapors, or spray. Avoid contact during pregnancy. Wash hands thoroughly after handling. If on skin, wash with plenty of water. Remove contact lenses if it gets in your eyes. Immediately rinse with water. Get emergency help. All that sort of thing. So these are actually statements that they will have for the safety of their employees during the manufacturing process. And some of that at the bottom was, you know, store locked up, dispose of contents a certain way, and that's for environmental safety. I'm familiar with this just from working in environments that was dealing with electronics. A lot of electronics have this kind of statement on them because a lot of times you're dealing with lead or solvents or stuff like that. This has been compared to over-the-counter pain relievers. So let's take a look at that and see, are they really worse than statins? Well, I'm going to look at the big four: aspirin, acetaminophen, ibuprofen, and naproxen. As you can see, they're a lot less complicated, but very similar. They're all with carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. Tylenol has a nitrogen molecule in it also. So these are, in that sense, similar to statins, at least in their chemical makeup, but far less complex. These numbers are far lower than what you see in statins. So let's just look at acetaminophen and what its 3D structure looks like. So as you can see, it's a complex module, but far less complicated than any of the statins. So it's hard to tell from any of these 3D structures what is going to be the impact on a human being. It's trial and error. That's the only way to tell. Given to people, observe the results, say, well, he died, that wasn't good, you know, that sort of thing. So what does their chart look like? So all these are considered irritants. Two are considered health hazards, and naproxen is actually also considered acutely toxic. So let's drill down into the Tylenol and look at its data sheet. The first thing it says is harmful if swallowed. Warning, acute toxicity. I'm surprised that the skull and crossbones symbol isn't on here. It probably ought to be given this. You notice there are hundreds of companies that have reported the dangers of these chemicals, whereas with the statins, it was usually a lot fewer. It causes skin irritation, so there's the irritant, causes serious eye irritation. Harmful to aquatic life with long-lasting effects. So this really could have three of these chemical warnings on it. Why it's only one, I don't know. I think the database is incomplete and they're probably filling it in as they go along. So the question we've got to ask is, well, are statins safer than these over-the-counter medications? Looking at those charts, to tell you the truth, I just finally added up the check marks that are there divided by the number of rows in the table, and both tables came out just under two. You certainly couldn't say that statins are safer than the over-the-counter medications. You might make a case that if you just throw out naproxen, well, then the over-the-counter painkillers are safer than statins. I won't go there. It's just like we can tell that it's approximately the same. There's certainly no way to say that statins are safer than over-the-counter medications. So let's revisit that point. So here's the statement that was made earlier. And there's one thing that's totally left out of this conversation by this opinion of the good doctor. What is the proper use, the intended use, or the recommended use of a statin? It's a daily, lifetime use. When they put you on statins, they say you have to promise to take this for the rest of your life. They know you're not going to, because 4 out of 5 people stop taking it within a few years because of too many side effects. So what is the intended or directed use of over-the-counter pain relievers? Occasional and limited use. Now, I know there are people who take Tylenol daily or take Motrin daily for prolonged periods, and yeah, they probably are doing serious damage to their internal organs, but that's not the normal directed use. I go on long hikes, as many of you know. I've done like 1,300 miles in the past 3 years on 3 lengthier trips, and I bring Motrin, I bring Tylenol with me, and I've probably only taken 2 or 3 doses in that whole time, and that was mostly after I slipped on some rocks and dislocated a shoulder. I was 9 miles from the nearest town, hiked into town, got a room at a hostel, and in order to sleep that night, yeah, I took some Motrin. I've given away more Motrin than I've taken, and unfortunately, hikers and runners I see refer to ibuprofen quite often as vitamin I, which is a bad way of looking at it. To be taking it constantly like that is really not good for them. I found no reason to do that, even hiking an average of 430 miles per hike over the past 3 years. It's just not necessary. So I do use these pain relievers on occasion, very rarely, but the way they're intended to be used. So let's go back to that statement that I highlighted earlier. Causes damage to organs through prolonged or repeated exposure. What is prolonged exposure? Lifetime use. What is repeated exposure? Well, daily. That prolonged repeated exposure is exactly the recommended dose of statins. So it can cause damage to these organs. Danger. Specific target organ toxicity. Well, what is the target organ of statins? It's the liver. So these things can cause liver damage, and even early on before they changed the recommendations, liver enzymes were being checked constantly if you were put on statins, and there was a good reason for that. So here's the problem with this argument by Dr. Taylor about statins being safer than over-the-counter medications. Not in the context of proper use. I think there's a red herring in here, and I got an argument with a fellow employee once, not an argument, but more of a discussion, because I'd said that a suggestion he made turned out to be a red herring, and he took offense at it because he thought I was saying that he had intentionally misled us. And that's not really what it always means. This is a definition from Wikipedia, so we know it must be right. A red herring is something that misleads or distracts from a relevant or important question. It can be either a logical fallacy or a literary device that leads readers or audiences towards a false conclusion. It may be used in intentionally, for example, as part of a rhetorical strategy. Well, what is rhetoric used for? It's used to win arguments. It's not really used to find truth. And that's what a lot of political discussions are. And that's what a lot of these medical discussions are. They go on to say, or may be used in argumentation inadvertently. I never ascribe motives to what people say. That's unfair to them. It's not an interactive discussion. They're not able to defend themselves. So I'm not going to suggest that this particular doctor was engaging in rhetoric. It may very well be that he thinks that, well, this is not a pertinent difference. I mean, he knows people take Tylenol daily or take Motrin daily. I believe it is, because that's not a lot of people in the grand scheme of things compared to people who are taking statins who do as directed, as their doctors insist, take it daily or sometimes every other day or whatever it is, and they're directed to take it for their lifetimes. Maybe this doctor thinks that's not pertinent. Maybe just didn't think of it. It didn't occur to him. Whichever. It's a red herring in this, because what is actually being done here is comparing apples to oranges. You can't compare statins used daily for a lifetime with over-the-counter pain relievers used daily for a lifetime. They probably are similar in hazard and safety. But if used properly, if used as intended, there's no comparison. Statins are by far more dangerous than over-the-counter medications. So that's all I've got on this topic today. If you appreciate this content, please like, share, subscribe, hit the notification bell so every Friday morning it'll tell you at 6 o'clock I post something new, and comment on this or other topics you'd like me to cover. And if you haven't seen this video, I recommend you take a look at it now. Thanks for listening.